Good morning, and welcome to the 38th annual Oakville Prayer Breakfast. I'm Moira Brown. Here we are again, a virtual breakfast. Who would have thought that for the second year, we would not be able to gather in the Oakville Convention Center to enjoy a real breakfast, to pray and worship together, to see each other's faces, and hear the buzz in the room of people gathering on the first Wednesday of Advent. Nonetheless, this morning we will celebrate the impact of God's love in our community. Perhaps you're watching with a coffee in one hand, bagel in the other, from your office or at home. We're glad you've joined us. If you walk many of the lovely paths of the Oakville Heritage Trails, you'll enjoy a handsome display of Indigenous history in the area. Our land has been the site of human activity for over 15,000 years. Oakville is situated on the ancestral treaty lands and territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation, part of the Anishinaabe Nation. The Oakville Prayer Breakfast Committee would like to acknowledge the stewardship of this land by the Anishinaabe and Métis peoples over these many years. Recognition of the contributions of Indigenous peoples is consistent with the Canadian commitment to making the promise of truth and reconciliation real in our communities. We are grateful for the opportunity to live, work, and play here, and thank all those who have served and continue to serve as caretakers of this special land. We are also mindful of the significant role various Christian churches played in assimilation of Indigenous children at the Indian residential schools in Canada. In our shame and sorrow, we stand in solidarity with all those who have experienced the trauma caused by the Canadian residential school system. We commit to learning and practicing how we can decolonize this land and our practices. Once again, welcome. Let's begin our prayer breakfast with prayer.
We welcome committee member James Montague, along with Andrew Beauchesne, to lead us.
Holy God, we gather in your name. We come with one voice to honor and praise you for choosing us as your people and for calling us to be signs of your love in our world. Help us to be women and men of vision, to see your face in each other we meet, to carry out our ministry with care for your sacred word. Give us the faith and courage we need to help build a world bursting with promise. Give us the wisdom and the knowledge to act responsibly and compassionately. We ask your help for all those who are in need, for those who suffer because of illness, poverty, or grief, for those who feel no love. Gracious God, you are the great creator of all things. Bless our plans and projects. Let our lives embody your truth and inclusiveness. Let our love flow through us. Make us sources of your grace for those whom we lead. Keep us connected to you throughout this day, and that everything we do today should glorify your name through Christ our Lord. Help us make this day a holy day.
May God bless us with the joy of knowing that we have acted out of love, that we have done our best, and that we have served God and Jesus with all our hearts. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I trust your coffee and breakfast are just what you ordered. I have the privilege of chairing the Oakville Prayer Breakfast Organizing Committee this year, and we are glad that you have joined us for the 38th annual Oakville Prayer Breakfast. We are a diverse group of people committed to our faith. We come from many Christian churches and are brought together in the desire to bring glory to God by witnessing to the deep, rich, and empowering experience of Jesus Christ in our lives. The first Oakville Prayer Breakfast was held in December 1984, following the format of the National Prayer Breakfast. If the Spirit is stirred in you by your participation in our event today, we invite you to expand your experience and look to the Burlington Prayer Breakfast, the Ontario Prayer Breakfast, and the National Prayer Breakfast. You will find links to these prayer breakfasts, as well as the archives of prior year Oakville breakfasts, at our new and improved website, oakvilleprayerbreakfast.com. Many of you have witnessed the history because you have been with us for many of these 38 years. We are so pleased that you could join us again. We are always inspired by the new people who join us each year. We are grateful to our sponsors, Manulife Securities, the Don Levy Group, Charity Accounts, Capriva Taylor Funeral Home, Oakview Funeral Home, Glen Oaks Funeral Home and Cemetery. We also express our appreciation to the businesses that have discounted their services to make us look good on screen and on the web. OTBX Air and Web Presence Design Lab. All of these sponsors have made the Oakville Prayer Breakfast financially viable this year. We are also grateful to those of you who supported us with a donation when registering for your ticket. While expressing gratitude this year, please join me in thanking the ministry provided by the Good Book Store in Oakville. They closed this fall after supporting our community for the last 30 years. May all who ministered there be blessed. In planning this time of prayer, we were mindful of the issues of 2021. We have been shocked by the voices that accuse the community we love of anti-Black racism, colonization, oppression, and exclusion of many in our community. There is no rational defense for some of the accusations. There is no excuse for others, especially the abuse of children. When we apply a Christian lens to any oppression, we see Jesus staring back at us and sitting in solidarity with the disenfranchised. Our civic, provincial, and federal leaders are asked to come up with a better way. We're here to pray that they can and do find that better way. What can we do, you and I? The committee suggests we can sit together and listen. Our speaker has lived a difficult childhood in Canada, suffering from systemic and personal oppression. May we feel her oppression, and may we celebrate the woman that she has become. May we also appreciate fully the impact of street ministries in our community. Let us listen with an open mind and open heart and trust that Jesus will show us a better way. May we always have the courage to follow his lead. I pray that your faith may be nourished through your participation in this prayer breakfast this morning. God bless.
It's my pleasure to bring greetings from all elected officials and public service employees. We work together to try to make Oakville Canada's most livable town. We hope that whenever you have an idea to make our town more livable, you'll let us know. Please keep well, stay safe, and let me know whenever you need help with any level of government.
Our English word prayer derives from the Latin precarious, I-U-S. We pray because life is often precarious, I-O-U-S. Canadian psychologist David G. Benner describes prayer as the soul's native language. He adds that our natural posture is attentive openness to the divine. Prayer is the most important thing in life. So let's welcome Prayer Breakfast Committee member Tony Odell to lead us in prayer. Following that, we'll be led in song by Kira Mathias, a grade 12 student from King's Christian Collegiate.
Philippians 4, verses 6 to 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Let us join our hearts in prayer. Father God, please clear our minds of the distraction and busyness of the week. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather in your name and allow each one of us personally and collectively to quiet our hearts so we can hear your voice. Father, we pray for our national leaders, Prime Minister Trudeau and his newly appointed cabinet, who are dealing with such monumental challenges: climate change, racial diversity and inclusion, mental health and loneliness, just to name a few, all set against the backdrop of an unprecedented global pandemic. Father, we ask for your wisdom and discernment to guide the decision-making in confronting these issues. We pray specifically for our Indigenous communities throughout the land. Their collective plight and pain have been in clear view as we confront the generational trauma caused by residential schools and a racial reckoning of discrimination and hate. We ask for your grace and wisdom to guide our leaders as they chart a path to truth and reconciliation. May it be your truth that opens the pathway to meaningful reconciliation. James 1, verse 5. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. We pray for our provincial premier, Ford, and his leadership team, who are dealing with the impacts of COVID-19. We pray for our municipal leaders, Halton Regional Chair Gary Carr, and our local Oakville Mayor Rob Burton, as they confront the never-ending challenges in the wake of COVID. We pray that these leaders will seek your wisdom and discernment and will allow you to guide their ways. COVID-19 has produced unimaginable suffering as many are distanced from loved ones at the most vulnerable times. We pray that your love and comfort are with them at their darkest times. We pray that our leaders will continue to find ways to financially support those who lost their jobs, their businesses, and some their life savings, all because of a health crisis beyond their control. We pray for those who are struggling with mental health issues, issues made more acute by the crisis. We pray that our leaders will have the sensitivity and compassion to prioritize support for these programs. Provide all our leaders with the understanding on how to provide the right path forward out of this pandemic. Romans chapter 5, verses 3 to 5. Not only so, but we glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. We pray for our educational leaders who seek to continue to inspire and educate while ensuring our children's health and safety. We pray for our healthcare workers who have walked a path that many of us simply cannot imagine. We pray for the protectors of our community, the police, firefighters, paramedics, and military. In many ways, they see the worst of our society every day. Please guide these leaders of these essential services to serve with compassion and love. We pray for our judicial leaders who are tasked with bringing justice to a broken world. Let them be guided by the Holy Spirit to provide the vision to transform the laws where needed to deliver social justice. We pray for our business leaders. May they continually be guided by your higher purposes and not simply by earthly gain. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. We pray for parents and all of those who lead, mentor, and guide our youth. Lord, let your loving hands discipline and disciple the next generation. Give us the patience and wisdom to reach out to the youth who may be disconnected, distracted, and lost. We pray for the youth who will be the next generation of leaders. May they lead with your spiritual gifting and compassion, and may your light shine brightly through them. Father, we pray for our keynote speaker, Cheryl Nembhard. Thank you for guiding her with insight as she prepared for today. We pray that your spirit will speak to each one of us through her message. Colossians 4, verses 2 to 3. Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful, and pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ. Bless our local church and pastoral leaders. Please give them the strength and perseverance to lead, teach, and equip us on our spiritual journeys. Give each one of us who proclaim you as Lord and Savior the boldness to be your hands and feet, to serve our neighbors and our communities, and to proclaim your mighty name. Father, we know that you hear all of these prayers and those unspoken. We pray for all of these things in the mighty name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Should the world try to break you
Cheryl Nembhard is a dynamic international speaker, author, podcast, and TV host. She's an award-winning social justice advocate who also uses her artistic talents in film and theater to tackle some of the toughest societal topics. Her dedication to community service includes working with at-risk youth, former gang members, sexual assault victims, and teenage mothers. Her not-for-profit educational theater company, EMG Education, has performed special assemblies on topics such as mental health, anti-black racism, and bullying in over 190 high schools across Ontario, impacting over 85,000 students and counting. So much more could be said, but I love this. CBC Canada has recognized Cheryl as one of 150 black women who are making Canada a better place. But first, two Oakville High School students will read from the Old and New Testaments. Let's listen to God's Word.
This is a psalm of thanksgiving for deliverance and prayer for help. A reading from the Psalms. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire, and set my feet on a rock, and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A reading from the New Testament, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verse 1 to 12. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountain. And after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. The word of the Lord.
Well, God bless you, each and every one of you that are watching from the Oakville Prayer Breakfast. What a joy and a privilege it is to just be before you for a few moments. My name is Cheryl Nembhard, and I'm just so thankful for all of you that have gathered to pray, to reflect, to sit in community and continue to grow and be challenged in our faith, in being better citizens, in finding ways to help uplift the city of Oakville. That is such a blessing. You are such a blessing. I'm so thankful for all of you. Well, you know, when I think about this season, I have to admit, I've got a confession to make. I'm a bit of a Christmas nut. Are you? I am absolutely obsessed with the season of Christmas. I'm laughing because there's about three things I want to share, but I do not want to confess my obsession just yet. Let's just say that a certain person right after Halloween, November 1st, switches into Christmas gear. Is there anyone like me that cannot wait to start playing the music and watching the films and putting up Christmas lights and just beginning to get into that Christmas cheer? I don't know what it is. Since I was a kid, there is something so special about this time. And I was sitting just for a few moments thinking like what I wanted to share with you from my heart. And the two words that kept coming up to me around this season are love and light. And I think about love because if we're honest with ourselves, I think Christmas is one of those rare times that we're a little extra nicer. We're a little bit kinder. There's more love in the air, more smiles one to the other. There's something heartwarming as the days approach to the Christmas season. And I also think about lights. I think about, oh my goodness, growing up, I was fascinated with Christmas lights. And I don't know about you, but having a family of my own, they're all adults now. But when they were little, I would pack them in the car and for like just as an activity, almost every week, we would drive for hours and look at that lights on houses and go to parks and just see all the Christmas lights. There was something just so wonderful about watching all of that. And it reminded me how that illumination of light draws our attention. It calls to us almost. We look and find these places that are so beautifully lit for Christmas. And, you know, in this beautiful invitational type of way, that is the life that God's called us to be. To be light, to be that beautiful light illuminating in the darkness. And what are we illuminating? What are we spreading as we glow, if you will? Well, it's the love of God. We are extending and sharing the love of God to those in a broken, hurting, dark world. If we're honest with ourselves, my friends, I would say when I look at 2020, 2021, it's twin sister, twin brother. I don't think we've ever been in a darker, heavier, more polarizing, more conflicting time as we've been. It truly is overwhelming, isn't it? And in some instances, for so many of us, it has been discouraging. It has been draining. It has felt like an uphill battle. So many people dying on hills and camps and fighting and infighting and parties and separation and distrust and fear and all the things. But I am a firm believer that it is the love of God. It is sharing the love of God. It is being the love that God pours in our hearts and reflecting his heart, that is what heals. That is what mends, that is what unites across all dividing lines. It seems simple, but it's what God has called us to do and to be. You know, I think about light and I think about those in darkness. You know, whenever I get to speak to at-risk youth, marginalized kids, young pregnant moms, ex-drug addicts, gang members, all of my tribe, I always have this beautiful, wonderful moment where we can shut off all the lights and I just flick a lighter and ask them if they can see it. And they say yes, no matter where they are, just for a moment. And then we turn the lights on. And I say, isn't it powerful that such a little light can be seen in a room this big that's so dark? That is the power of love. That is the power of sharing the love of God to someone else. That is what we are commissioned to do. Can I be honest with you? It was love that changed my life. It was love that pursued me, that healed my broken heart, that literally renovated me from the inside out. And I will say, and this is so important to hang on to, that in my defining moment, which ironically was just around this time. Literally, it was just weeks before Christmas that my life changed forever as a 19-year-old. But it wasn't scripture. It wasn't a good sermon at first. It wasn't a prayer at first. It was an urban missionary filled to the brim with the love of God, who simply, quietly, unendingly loved on me and loved me until the hardness, the cemented walls of my heart melted and became soft again. It was love. I didn't even know what he believed. I had a sense, but I didn't even know because he put the person of Cheryl over the position of denomination and religion. He saw a soul that needed love first before it needed saving. Huge, huge. And I feel like God is challenging us in this area. You know, I think about the verse in Matthew that says that we are the light of the world, a city set on a hill that cannot be hidden. It's like that lighter. Just that tiny spark of light can illuminate so much. And I call that being a lighthouse. I have this phrase where I call you and I that we're called to be lighthouses. Follow me for a minute. So imagine that lighthouse structure, right? Grounded, firm, stable, sometimes elevated, lifted up on a rock, if you will, or on some sort of high cliff. And its job, well, it's to illuminate light to all those that are journeying, all those that are traveling, those that are facing the storms of the sea and the storms of life, if you will, and helping them to find safe passage, helping them, in other words, to navigate the storms of their lives without crashing on the rocks. That's you and I. We are called to be lighthouses in dark times. So in these moments, I always say, this that we're seeing now, as much as we want to curl into a corner and just say, ugh, I throw up my hands, I'm done. What a beautiful opportunity. What an amazing moment. What an invitation that Jesus is giving you and I to not shrink back, but to lean in, to love harder, to love intentionally, and to love across all dividing lines. You know, so many things can obstruct the light of a lighthouse. And if you and I are a lighthouse, using that example, there's so many things that can block our giving of pure, unfiltered joy, love, peace, hope of God. Religion can do that. Sometimes we can get caught up in that and all of the fine details around denominationalism and lines. And racism can do that. You know, our thoughts on immigrants can do that. You know, brokenness can do that. Carrying past wounds and angers can, you know, do that. The way we see the world, if it's distorted, can do that. And all of these things can come in the way. But it's not the love that God is calling us to. I'm reminded in Luke, so beautiful, that the lawyer meets Jesus and he says, what do I need to do to inherit eternal life? Basically, what do I need to do to make it in? That's all of us. What do we need to do, God, to make it in? And Jesus says, you're a lawyer. You know the law. You tell me. And he says, okay, well, the Bible says, you know, the law says, love the Lord, your God, with all your mind, all your heart, your soul, your being, and to love your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus says, I love it. What a beautiful teacher, answering a question with a question. Shout out to all the teachers out there. And he says, that's great. That's perfect. Do that. Do that. And you will inherit eternity. Well, the next moment, I think about the lawyer, and I have to be honest, that is so many of us. The lawyer's like, okay, let me run through the checklist. Love the Lord with all my heart, soul, mind. That's great. Do church. Do all the things that look like Christianity, things that feel like I'm going to gain favor with God. Check, 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 check. And love my neighbor as myself. Whoa. What do you mean by that? Who is my neighbor? And that is not as simple a question as you think. It was actually a trick question. It was very loaded. In other words, if I can paraphrase, like who is worthy of my love? Who do you want me to love again? The lawyer is all of us. You know, we want to love who we know. We want to love who we're comfortable with. We want to love the people that we want to love. But the truth is, when the question goes out, who is my neighbor? The answer comes back, and it's a resounding everyone. Everyone is our neighbor. We are called to love everyone. And I am so glad that this time, many years ago, when I was 19 years old, that a young man filled with the love and compassion of God, who was called to love those that were so-called unlovable, those that lived on the streets, the marginalized, saw me and loved me with the love of God. You see, I was broken, I was shattered, I was hurting, I was angry, I was wounded to the core. But I didn't live that way by choice, and I didn't start off that way. Like so many at-risk youth, so many that live on the streets, we were dropped. Our brokenness was because we were dropped and shattered into a million pieces. Some of us at a young age, a tender age. And so many of us in our lives, you'll see so many just trying to put the pieces of that shatteredness back in their adult life together again. For me, a young woman sexually abused from a child from the age of 5, unfortunately at the hands of a Sunday school teacher. And so imagine now, someone who is looking to the church for protection and for love and care being abused at the hands of those who were supposed to represent love, the love of God. And that is so true for so many. When I speak to at-risk youth, when I'm talking to those on the street, speaking to ex-gang members, that is the number one thing that they share. I was hurt. I was wounded. I'm angry at the church because, and it is always around the way they were treated. No one talks about how great a verse was. No one talks about how great a sermon was. They talk about how they were treated by the church and how it affected them and impacted their life negatively. I feel like there's a lesson there. I feel like God is saying something to you and I there. The way we love literally is a reflection of who we serve. And it should be a true reflection. If the kingdom of God had a business card, it would be love. You know, the way in which we love one another. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love one another as I have loved you, Jesus said. Yeah, you know, I think about that young man, Chris is his name, who for 3 months loved me unconditionally, didn't see skin color, didn't see social status, didn't look at the crimes I had committed because I had been in a gang, didn't look at any of those things, but saw a soul that needed to be loved, not a soul that needed to be saved first. And for 3 months, I didn't hear a verse. I need you to hear that. For 3 months, I didn't hear a sermon. I want to challenge your thinking around evangelism as well while I'm here. Might as well while I'm here. He loved on me. He loved on me. I'm reminded of the Samaritan. He just saw my brokenness and my woundedness, and he tended to my wounds, period. You know, when I was young, I realized a quick equation growing up, and it's one that I see in every broken, shattered youth that I minister to. Those who are wounded, deeply hurt, that hurt left unresolved, unhealed, unprocessed, unworked through, over time morphs into anger. And maybe even you have felt this way at some point in your life, or are still working through some of these issues as well. And those who are angry at how life has treated them, angry at how the world has dealt cards for them, angry at what they've experienced in their childhood, left unresolved, left unhealed, left unworked through, morphs over time into bitterness and forms seeds of bitterness in our heart. And at 13, I was a bitter, angry young girl. And I made a very hard, damaging choice. I joined a gang. And from 13 to 16, I was with this gang. And I joined this gang not because I was rebellious, not because I was crime motivated, not because I was a bad seed, because I was broken, because I wanted family. I was raised by a single mom, no father, no siblings, nothing, only child. And gangs felt like family. Please hear me. I joined a gang because I wanted community. I felt unloved, unaccepted, and I wanted the acceptance, and I found it in that gang. And why am I leaning into that so heavily? Maybe God is calling you in this moment to shift your thinking, to see demographics differently, to see groups differently, and to know that any angry, wounded teen you see, if you can scrape all of that off and get to the root of it, they're really hurt. They're really broken. They've been shattered by some instance or situation. And at the age of 16, I ran away after a sexual assault from some members of the gang that turned on me. And for 3 years, I was on and off the street. And I was so broken. I began a spiral into even darker moments of my life where I didn't care whether I lived or died. I was self-harming. I had suicidal thoughts. I was doing drugs just to numb out the pain because that was escapism. And I wanted nothing to do with anything or anyone. And I barely wanted to live. And this young man loved me. And that love melted every cement that I had put up around my heart. Every hardness of my heart melted because he showed the love of God. You know, when we ask who is our neighbor, we know that the answer is everyone. I want to encourage you right now, even as I'm talking, to hear this thought and just take it in. We who are followers, we who have the love of God, must be known as a people of compassion. Yeah, we must lead from a place of compassion. We must be compassionate in the way we speak and treat and live with one another. In light of the issues of the day, we need to step out of our comfort zones and love across dividing lines. Love those that don't look like us. When we see someone hungry, we need to feed them. Thirsty, we need to give them drink. You know, we need to check in with those that are failing and falling and spiraling. And even in your own life, think about those in your family, those in your world that are crumbling, that are hit hard in this season. Are there ways that you can love them intentionally? Are there things that even God's stirring up that you can do in big or small ways to show the love of God, to punch some light into their darkness? You know, the truth is that being a good neighbor means that we're not just called to love, but we're called to also stand alongside, to speak for those that don't have a voice, to advocate for those who need advocating, to bring justice where there's injustice. And it may look different in different seasons, but I believe that God is calling us to be more intentional in the way we love. It's not good enough anymore to just have a great Sunday service. It's not good enough anymore to just be a good Christian. We need to step out. We need to love. We need to be God's hands extended in a time where people are hurting the most. I just want to encourage you to love those that don't look like you, to love those that may not believe what you believe, to love those that may not stand for what you stand for. Because that's when love is truly tested. It's not really love when we're not tested in that muscle. If we're just loving people that look like us, loving people that say what we say, go where we go, believe what we believe, that's love in part. 2021 is calling us to love outside of our comfort zone. Yeah. And I encourage you to be that lighthouse, to be love extended. I encourage you in this season to think about ways in your local community to help those in need and to also remember those who are doing the hard, tough work of street ministry. They are the unsung heroes. I am a product of someone who did not give up on me. You know, my friends, from our brothers and sisters in the BIPOC community, those of color, those in the Indigenous First Nations community, our brothers and sisters there, those in the LGBTQ plus community, those that don't believe what we believe, of different religions, of no religion, of all walks of life. The simple, powerful truth is that God loves them, they matter to him, and Jesus died for them as well. And if they matter to God, they need to matter to us. And if he loves them, we need to love them as well. This season, I pray that each and every one of us redefine love, not only for ourselves, but for us as believers, that we really examine and redefine what it means practically day in and day out. To those that we walk past and have walked past, to those that we have labeled wrongly, perhaps, to those that we don't give time to. Our greatest identifier is not how well we preach. It's not how many verses we've memorized. It's not how many Sundays we've spent in the house of God. Our greatest identifier, the one that matters, the one that will be measured, the one that is connected to eternal life, is how well we have loved one another. My prayer for you is that you be love and light to those in this troubling dark time. Shine on. Shine, my friends. Shine for God. God bless you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Cheryl, for sharing your inspiring vision and passion today. May it spur us all on to love and good deeds. Thank you to all who participated this morning. Please pray that we'll be able to meet in person for the 39th annual Oakville Prayer Breakfast on December 7th, 2022. If you would be interested in becoming a member of the organizing committee, please reach out to us through our Oakville Prayer Breakfast website. Heads up, you're going to be receiving an email with a short survey to glean your thoughts on our event today. We would really appreciate your feedback. We also recognize that you don't have the opportunity this year to make a donation in the Salvation Army kettles, usually in the lobby at the Oakville Conference Center. However, we encourage everyone to be generous to various charities who help the less fortunate at this time of year. Mother Teresa said, "All of us must cling to God through prayer. My secret is simple. I pray. Through prayer, I become one in love with Christ. I realize that praying to Him is loving Him. In the silence of the heart, God will speak." Well, let's unite our hearts one more time with the one who has the whole world in His hands, as well as the plan for you and me. We're going to pray God's living and active word right back to Him from the Psalms in the Passion Translation. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, it is so enjoyable to come before you with uncontainable praises spilling from our hearts. How we love to sing our praises over and over to you, to the matchless God, high and exalted over all. At each and every sunrise, we will be thanking you for your kindness and your love. As the sun sets and all through the night, we will keep proclaiming, "You are so faithful. For Yahweh is always good and ready to receive you. He's so loving that it will amaze you, so kind that it will astound you. And He is famous for His faithfulness toward all. Everyone knows our God can be trusted, for He keeps His promises to every generation. He will care for the needy and the neglected when they cry to Him for help. The humble and helpless know His kindness, for with a father's compassion, He will save their souls. They will be rescued from tyranny and torture, for their lifeblood is precious in His eyes. May our city and our nation be full of praising people, fruitful and fulfilled, so that Your name may be honored forever. Lord, strengthen us deep within our souls and breathe fresh wisdom and courage for these challenging days. God, keep us near Your mercy fountain and bless us. And when You look down on us, may Your face beam with joy. In Jesus' name, amen.
Christ.